having an abnormal immune system probably predisposes a lot of people to develop different cancers. So what we've discovered so far is just the tip of the iceberg. We're looking at people who have very severe immunosuppression in some cases. But what's the pattern of cancer risk in people who have less severe immunosuppression? That's something we want to look at down the road. I'm Eric Engels. I'm a senior investigator in the Infections and Immunoepidemiology branch of the Division of Cancer Epidemiology and Genetics at the National Cancer Institute. After I got my Master's of Public Health degree, I came to the National Cancer Institute for postdoctoral training, and I learned about epidemiology, and that's what I've been studying ever since, the epidemiology of infections and the immune system and how that affects people's risk of cancer. Our branch focuses on the full range of immune and infection-related causes of cancer. My work on immunosuppressed populations interfaces with work by my colleagues in the branch looking at viral causes of cancer. Transplant recipients are immunosuppressed because they take medications to prevent them from rejecting their transplanted organ. In many ways, they're similar to people with AIDS in terms of their immunosuppression, and they get some of the same cancers. Also, people who have autoimmune conditions are at risk for some cancers, both because of the autoimmune condition itself and also the treatments that those patients receive that suppress their immune system. Many of those patients can develop lymphomas, for example, and that's something that we're studying. We're trying to understand how disturbances in the immune system in general, whether it's an overactive immune system or an underactive immune system, can influence people's risk of cancer. We use a big data approach to our cancer research. We make use of large databases called registries that collect information on hundreds of thousands of people or millions of people. And we link these databases together in order to look at the risk of cancer in people with HIV or people who have a transplant. So a focus of our work is on describing overall trends and looking for patterns, but then we follow that up with mechanistic studies. In the future, I can see continuing this line of research. There's a lot more to learn about cancer in HIV-infected people and transplant recipients. Due to improvements in treatment, these individuals are living longer, they're aging, and their pattern for developing cancer may change over time. That's something we want to monitor, looking for new signals that may lead us to new discoveries about the etiology of cancer.